John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for me coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden here in March. I haven't done one of these in a while. Today we're going to do a Q&A, answer guys' organic gardening questions. If you guys have an organic gardening question for me, I'll post a link down below to my community tab here on YouTube. Just post your question there. I pull through those questions to make up the list that I'll be answering today, so maybe you could be featured in next month's episode. All right, let's go on with the questions. First question is from Rebecca A. I can't go get trees from Seamus. I have no car. I'm in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico. Please advise sourcing fruits and edible perennials here. My diet is just starting to transition, but I won a food forest grant in Everett, Washington a couple years ago. I really enjoy the education you provide. Slow as I am, it's very encouraging and motivates me to do something different every day. Thank you. All right, so I've never been to Truth or Consequences, New Mexico, and I don't know the nurseries down there or anything. And here's the thing, if you don't have a car, that really, you know, limits your ability to go to nurseries and see what's available. So I think the internet is your best friend. I would do, you know, searches on maybe Craigslist or OfferUp if anybody sells plant starts down there. I would search local farms and find out what trees grow well down there. Because, I mean, I don't know that I'd just go to Seamus automatically. Because, I mean, unless you're in the Phoenix or surrounding area where they have a similar climate, you know, some of his trees may not perform well and just not make it for you. If you did want to get, you know, tropical fruit trees, there's many websites that you can order from them online and they will ship them to you. Once again, I would do your research to find out what's going to grow in your specific climate zone and your area. I'm not familiar with that, so I wouldn't know. On perennial vegetables, you know, definitely, I mean, same thing. I mean, a lot of the perennial vegetables I buy are sourced maybe even from eBay, finding specific varieties that I need, and they'll ship me vegetables. Oh, and another really good source for plants actually is Etsy. Check out Etsy. I've ordered plants from Etsy. Actually, I got some wasabi plants from Etsy that are actually like true wasabi, like they use in, like, you know, sushi restaurants from Japan. Like, this is like the true wasabi. So yeah, Etsy could work too. So I mean, those are my best recommendations, but, you know, do some research and make sure, you know, the plants you're gonna get are the ones that are gonna do good for you. The other thing is, especially when you start, you gotta start ordering plants, man, it really starts sucking up the money fast. So it'd be better to try to find somebody locally that grows plants that already has a food forest that you get cuttings from or plant starts from. That's what I'd recommend for you guys. All right, next question is Puppy Cow. What is your favorite genus? So my favorite genus of plants, of course, are the Brassica family of plants. As I am here in my cool season garden, you guys can see right behind me, this is my purple Mizuna. This bed right here, I got like red boar kale, but I also got some, you know, lettuce and chard plants in there. Oh, I just pulled out my, just back there, I just pulled out my dinosaur kale that I just actually finished eating this morning for breakfast. But I love the tree collards and I love all the different Asian light greens, the Mizuna, Komatsuna. There are just so many different Brassica family plants. The arugula I have flowering back there. I'm growing arugula. The kale, the collard greens, the broccoli, the cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, all these things. I mean, the reason why I love Brassica plants so much is because they're just fairly easy to grow, number one. Number two, they are packed full of micronutrients, things like trace minerals and phytochemicals and anti-cancer compounds, compounds that help your stage 2 liver detoxification, you know, and compounds that help make us younger. So I want you guys to eat some greens every single day. And then you also ask my favorite family of plants. So my favorite family of plants would be the Asteraceae. I can't say that. Aster family of plants. So that's like the lettuce family. And then we also have things like, I guess the dandelions would be in that, I think, general family too. And the aster family is so cool. I mean, what? Like, I think the sunflowers in the aster family. There's so many cool, I mean, I love plants. I know the edible ones and non-edibles, I don't know, but, you know, so that's what I'm going to tell you guys. I mean, the Ricardia picroides, which actually I don't have currently growing in my garden, so it's my goal to get some seeds started this year. Hopefully I can get them coming up and growing again. Those plants are amazing. Next question is from James. Why use bags slash sack for compost as opposed to put the compost into a bucket to make loose tea? So I think he's talking about, you know, like tea bags or, you know, bags to make brew your compost tea in, and instead of just putting the compost in a bucket to make tea. So here's the thing, like, number one, there's a few things. Like, if you just aerate a bucket with loose stuff going around in there, you know, your bubbler is likely to get clogged up with all the grit that's in there. So, you know, using a bag to filter out and not allow the small grit to basically clog up the pores and make your pump or your air stones all messy, right? Now, the other thing, very important, many people may not know this, but there's totally, they've researched this, right? And like one guy, he designed his compost tea brewer so that the stones would be just, or the way the air came out would be like X inches, I don't remember how many inches, 12 inches right below where the tea was sitting or the compost was sitting, that it would then aerate, because he determined the right size of the bubble and how much space should be between, you know, where the bubbles come out and it hits the tea. You know, and I don't know what that is, man. I just use like my brewer that has that preset, but you know, that's how extreme you could get. And when you just have all the stuff in there, right, things are floating around, maybe some things are getting more air than others, maybe the heavy particles sink to the bottom, the light particles sink to the top, and this way you're able to suspend it all. So that's what I'm gonna tell you guys. Next question is from Rodrigo Garcia. Free range worms. Have you ever tried to produce worms without a container? This is how it works. You put the material 1 foot thick, just layering over the pathways, covered with cardboard and mulch. After filling the whole path, start over again in the pathway next to the garden bed. Wish you give it a try. No more worms in containers. You can literally just move them simply by moving the worm food. Free range worm castings. I follow you for over 12 years. Love your work. All right, Rodrigo. Yes, I agree. Free range worms is the way to go. You know, whether you want to put it in your, you know, pathways, depending on where you live. Like, I couldn't get away with doing my pathways here because my pathways are just way too dry. It dry out the worms. Instead, my free range worms live in my garden beds, you know? I have tons of worms in the garden beds. I feed the garden beds with compost and other nutritive materials that the worms love to eat, and they poop in the beds, so that now I don't have to move the castings either, you know? In your method where you have it in the pathways, now you gotta dig up the pathways to get the castings and then put in your garden beds, unless you're maybe gonna grow in the pathways the following season. I don't know how you're gonna do that. But yeah, I agree that worms optimally should not be kept in containers. You know, number one, I'm gonna kill them if they're in a container, because now I got one extra thing to do to take care of them, their health, their, you know, the moisture level. You know, can't get too hot for them. If you like in the desert, you gotta like maybe even put ice on them to keep them cool in the summertime. Too much to deal with. I'm gonna have them in the ground. You know, link down below if I remember to a video I made where you can make an in-ground worm house, so that, like a worm feeding station in your raised beds, so that they could be in there so that you don't have to manage them in a container. Yes, free range worms, excellent idea. Next question is from Andrew Foley. Tips on starting moringa seeds. Seems like I've tried everything with no success. Seeds are from Baker Creek. Even tried two different packets. All right, Andrew, so moringa seeds. So number one, I wait until the weather heats up. And even then, when it heats up, I then will also use the heat mat. So usually I start them in my greenhouse under heat mats. Probably about now. I mean, the weather's been in like the 70s/80s and maybe even hitting 90 this weekend. And then I'll put them in there with heat mats. And what I do is basically I use like coconut coir that I soak down really good. So it's like really soaked down coconut coir. Then I basically just pop the seeds in there, just like that much below the soil. And then I just put them on the heat mat, and I pretty much don't water them every day. I just like leave the water that's in there that like I soaked them in advance, so it's nice and moist in there, and they just sprout up. And I usually get pretty good germination depending on the seeds you're using. I haven't tested the germability of the Baker Creek seeds, but I know they do germ testing on all their seeds, so you should have some good seeds. But yeah, use the heat mat, I think, number one, and you know, make sure it stays moist enough, and try not to like constantly disturb the soil and keep watering it. Try to just get it nice and moist, and hopefully they'll come up for you. All right, next question is from Kurt Remy Slettmeyer. What, in your opinion, is the ultimate all-year farming method given a decent-sized crop for minimal effort? All right, ultimate all-year farming method. You know, that's tough to say. It depends on what crop are you growing. Also depends on what climate you're in, right? You know, I mean, I like raised bed gardening for most vegetables, but that doesn't mean once I have, you know, acreage of property, I'm not going to build raised beds over acreage of property. I'm probably going to do like more of a row garden. If you're growing fruit trees, you know, I wouldn't put those in raised beds either. You know, I wouldn't even have them in containers like I have my fruit trees here. I'd have them in the ground. So, you know, I would say it just depends. I mean, I guess the key word there is minimal effort, and I would say select your crops carefully, because some crops are more high maintenance, like some girlfriends or wives you may have had in the past, and some crops are more low maintenance, you know? So if like for my climate zone right here, the low maintenance tree that you guys wanna get is jujube tree, super low maintenance, doesn't require much work, is gonna produce a lot of stuff, even send up suckers, so you'll have even more trees without you doing much, right? And selecting the right crop for the time of year also could really make you succeed or fail. So, yeah, I mean, I would say sprouts. Sprouts are the ideal growing method you could use year-round. Just soak the seeds, rinse them a couple times a day, then you got some little sprouts you could eat. And so that's like maximum nutrient-rich crops for minimal effort. Just soak them, rinse them a few times a day, and you're done. And a few days later, nothing to go wrong. All right, next question is from Edgar Fong. Hello, John. I've watched your three YouTube channels and really enjoy them. Thanks. You seem like a pretty busy guy. Absolutely. It must take an incredible amount of time to prepare and eat healthy foods, let alone grow it all too. How do you find the time to live a full life beyond doing this? I know you frequently said that being healthy is the most important thing to you, but even if you live to be 100 and are absolutely energetic right to the last minute, is it worth it to know you spent your life trying to get there? What kind of things do you enjoy outside growing and eating healthy foods? Is it possible to have a good relationship and do what you do? I imagine it would be easier if you can find someone who also lives like this, but am guessing that must be hard. Are there things in life, if any, you feel you may have missed out on because of your lifestyle? The reason I ask that is that you have done a great job expressing why you do what you do and how to do it. But I've always believed there are pros and cons to everything, and I'd love to hear what you find to be the biggest drawbacks. All right, Edgar. So here's the thing. We all have a life on this planet to do with what we choose, provided it's, you know, legal and not going to hurt anybody and hopefully maybe enriches others. You know, I think that's success to me. So yes, I will absolutely say I spend more time growing and preparing food than any of my friends that I know of, and probably, I mean, most people that I've ever met in my life. I can't really think of too many other people that spend more time than me doing all this stuff. And you know, here's the thing, this is what I choose to spend my time with. I love to be out my garden, right? I love to teach with you guys and share with you guys what I've learned. You know, I love preparing food, knowing that it's you know, the healthiest food that like money can't buy, and that I'm gonna eat this food that I've grown with love, prepared with love, processed in the best way possible. And yes, I'm extreme and I'm crazy. I'm not gonna tell you guys I'm normal. I'm totally abnormal, man. But I also guess it comes back to like, I almost lost my life when I was younger too. And that's why I'm so serious about what I do these days. And to me, I really enjoy what I do. Yes, it takes a lot of time, you know? I mean, I'm not into sports. If I was into sports, maybe I'd watch sports on TV every Sunday, and I'm not. I don't really care about sports, right? I could care less about two corporations battling for the greater profit, like my grandpa said. You know, I don't go to sporting events and watch spectator sports. You know, hey, I would rather go out and throw a football than watch a football game. Now, you know, here's the thing. Yes, I will say I could use more exercise, and I could probably use some more friends to go toss a football with. You know, I'm maybe a little bit deficient in that area, so I'll definitely say that. But yeah, I really enjoy, you know, doing what I do. Now, outside of gardening, growing foods, processing foods, which is a big part of my life, what do I enjoy doing? Well, I like going out shopping and buying the organic foods and healthy foods that I don't grow myself and finding the best deals on them. That really excites me. I was recently in Los Angeles at the Wholesale Produce Terminal. I got some amazing deals on organically grown produce for super cheap and things that I literally can't find anywhere else. So that was quite fun. I really enjoy doing that. I love going to farmers markets, which I guess is part of the lifestyle that I live, but not because you never know what you're going to find. And then I love meeting people at farmers markets. They're doing really good work and maybe even being able to make videos about them and sharing them with you guys, because that could enrich your guys' life through my life. I like traveling, so I like visiting farmers markets and finding new people to connect with and maybe even making videos about them. And I love shopping. Shopping's so amazing. I also love travel. Travel is one of my big passions, man. I've collected lots of frequent flyer miles and even have lots of hotel points to basically fly wherever I'd like in the world and stay for free wherever I'd like in the world. And then when I'm there, of course, experience different cultures, experience the foods of different cultures, experience the farming of those cultures, how they process food and how they eat it. I mean, that's just my main interest. I mean, yeah, I like to look at historical facts, but I'm kind of more like really pragmatic and like, hey, how can going somewhere, I can visit the sites, you know, go out to nature. I love visiting nature. I love hiking and, you know, going out to the ocean. I love going to the beaches. I love playing in the water. I love, you know, hiking and rock climbing and just being physical, like getting physical activity in normal everyday situations. I don't like going to the gym. And yeah, I could use some more physical activity. I love connecting with people, you know, like I love running my business. You know, I love being an entrepreneur and trying to come up with new ideas, and especially, you know, somebody who got into marketing. That was my degree in marketing. I love creative ways on how to like make videos to, you know, help people out and teach them what I've learned in my life to make the world a better place, right? I mean, these things are all fun. I mean, it's basically integrated into my life. Do my relationships suffer because I eat so healthy and maybe don't have as many friends as I should? Absolutely. You know, I definitely could have more friends, but the thing is, friends could take a lot of time, especially friends that just talk to you and talk aimlessly about nothing. You know, I'm kind of more like get it done, you know, guy. Like, I have some friends that come over and garden with me, and we could garden and talk at the same time. I mean, that'd be a fun day to me, you know. let's see. So is it possible to have good relationships and do what you do? Like, I don't like friend relationships. Absolutely. I mean, I'm kind of more of a introvert slash maybe with extrovert tendencies, I suppose. And so I'm really good with just being with myself and my dog. And, you know, yeah, I mean, maybe my relationships are suffering a little bit. I mean, I would like to find a partner actually at some point that's really into this stuff. I think I can't really find a partner that's really not into this stuff, because unless you'd want to do things with me. I mean, because I've had relationships in the past where they just, you know, didn't want to garden with me. And I think that's like, that's something like, okay, I don't care if she's in a gardening now, but she has to want to garden or like learn to do what I like to do, right? Because it's important to me. And of course, I'd learn to do what she likes to do and hopefully enjoy it. And hopefully, you know, being able to do that with her would also make me happy, you know? It's just a relationship, give and take. Let's see. Are there things in life, if any, you feel you have missed out on because of your lifestyle? I mean, yeah, I don't go to bars and I don't drink. I mean, I don't miss going to bars and not drinking or partying or watching a sports game or making small talk. I've never really been any good at making small talk at bars, and I could care less about drinking and getting buzzed or whatever. So I haven't missed out on that. I mean, I could go gambling. I don't really particularly care for gambling because it's going to be a losing outcome. That's just the way it's set up to lose. So I don't really enjoy that. I like going to play pinball machines. Actually, I don't like video games so much, but pinball machines is amazing because I grew up with those, you know, playing real pinball machines. I mean, there's a lot of things I like to do. I actually like trying to like live more sustainably on the planet and research those ways to do that. I like driving my car, actually. Driving my car is quite fun. I also have driven motorcycles in the past, although it's gotten, you know, pretty dangerous, I guess, in this day and age to drive motorcycles with all the crazy drivers out there. But maybe I could get back to doing that one of these days. Some dirt bikes. Used to have some dirt bikes and go out my old boss, Brian Nichols. That was fun back in the day. But yeah, I mean, here's the thing. Like, I set up my life so that I could do what I want to do. I have free time, although you think I'm always in my garden working and making food. You know, I'll batch prepare food, I'll batch juice things, so I have like food already pre-made in my fridge so that now my day is pretty much free to do whatever I want. If there's a day I need to go to the trade show, I could leave because I have my food prepped. I could just grab the food I need to eat and eat it without having to like stop and make food for every single meal. So I really have implemented things to conserve time and save time and bulk food, prepare, and then be able to, you know, still have a real life if I wanted to do things out in, you know, the world. You know, I mean, I love escape rooms. I did a couple escape rooms, and actually those were quite fun to get your mind thinking. I mean, like bowling, just any outdoor activities. I mean, what I don't do, though, is I don't particularly care for eating out because a lot of restaurants won't cater to, like, my dietary needs and how I like to eat. Plus, like any restaurant I go to, it's gonna be quite rare that they're gonna have better quality food than I could grow at home. So, I mean, I guess you could call me a snob. And I guess it just comes down to this. It comes down to what is important to you, right? If you think growing food and living healthily is a waste of time, then do what's more important to you, man. I'm not here to like try to convince you to do how live how I live. I'm gonna tell you guys it's a full-time job living like I live, right? I've set up my life so I could do this because it is important to me. So do what is important to you. I mean, I think that's all I'm gonna say, right? I mean, I love what I do, and here's the thing, right? I mean, I believe and I've seen that living my lifestyle pays off. I mean, specifically, I mean, I have the closest genes to my brother that is 2 years younger than me, right? And meanwhile, you know, I'm fit and in shape, like about a mid-range BMI. You know, his BMI is obese, according to his doctor. You know, he has neck pains, leg pains, arm pains, you know, edema in his legs, probably pre-diabetic, I don't really know. He's probably got some other health conditions that I don't even know about or aren't even aware about, right? And so, you know, the time I figure I'm putting in now to you know, do things for my health will pay me off in the long run because I'm not going to have these critical incidences, you know, later in life that could just take you out one day. Like, oh, that guy was healthy until he got cancer stage 4 identified and then it was too late, right? I'm doing preventative things now. And to me, that's quite worth it. I mean, I think what I'm doing based on some of the science that I've read, because I follow science and I try to always modify my approach and what I'm doing to lead a healthier lifestyle. And to me, it's like putting money in the bank. I have a health bank account that I'm putting money into every time I grow my foods, grow it with the love and care and trace minerals and soil microbiome elements, and then prepare it with love and in the best ways possible. And yeah, you may think I'm fanatical because you're gonna probably go out and buy a McDonald's cheeseburger after this. But you know, my message is this. You don't have to live like me, but what I want you guys to do is if you're gonna eat that cheeseburger, hey, at least eat a big salad from your garden first, or at least a couple tomatoes out your garden, because you know, now you're just gonna offset the amount of McDonald's or other highly processed foods and any animal foods in excess that you may be eating. And I guess that's it. All right. Plus also preparing all my food gives me lots of exercise because I'm always walking here and there and you know, preparing things, picking things, washing things, and I'm like moving every part of the day. So I could get more real world activity like, you know, running or biking or something, but I'm like pretty much constantly in motion my whole day. All right, next question is from Austin G. Yo, John, coming at you from Houston, Texas here. First big fan, and thank you for all the amazing videos you have given us. So informative and interesting. My question is about soil. I've attempted to copy a more natural soil system into grass roots, living soil fabric pots. First, rock gravel at the bottom. Next layer is a layer of sand, sand filter, then a mixture of Fox Farm super soil and cow manure. Finally, the top soil layer being a mix of super soil cut with organic potting soil and worm castings. I have lots of green, healthy looking growth for the most part, but slow. My soil feels very clumpy and hard to break up. I think the issue maybe have been the cow manure. Do you think that introducing worms into the pots would help loosen the soil? Some promote better root growth. Also, what are your thoughts on this organic system? All right, Austin. So, you know, let's see. So you live in Houston. And so what I'm going to tell you guys, what I'm going to tell you is specifically is get your butt in the car and go up to, I think, what is it, Conroe, Texas, which is right outside of Houston, to Nature's Way Resources. I believe that's the company name. Link down below to my video I made out there. I would recommend just taking out what you have in the pots and then replacing about half of their fungal dominated mixture with the mixture that you have made. I personally wouldn't have put like just standard cow manure in to my pots because it could be contaminated with many different things. And I'm not a fan of basically just raw cow manure. I would want to, you know, properly processed. Anyways, check that dude out, Nature's Way Resources. He's got the best soil in your area and actually probably some of the best soil in the country. So you're really lucky to live in Houston. All right, the next question is from Ernestina Abera. Mr. A Million Juan. Hi, sir. I love your videos. So informing. Thank you. Is it okay to plant garlic under my fruit trees? Thank you. All right, yeah. So I would say, you know, if underneath your fruit trees gets lots of sun, I would say absolutely, why not, right? I have fruit trees. You could probably see some of them here, fig trees, and I have planted down below like garlic below it and cilantro below it, you know. I would say just when you're going to plant your garlic, just make sure that you're not disturbing the tree roots too much and like chopping them up to put your garlic in there. That being said, I would recommend, you know, putting your garlic in a more sunny spot, because underneath your trees, your fruit trees probably not getting a lot of sun, so your garlic's probably not going to produce like as well as it could in full sun. That's what I'm going to say. Next question is Andrew Foley. Tips on root knot nematodes. Found them on my tomatoes at the end of the season, and I'm trying to find solutions before this season. As I don't have a lot of room to crop rotate, I'll be pulling up infected roots and tilling the associated beds to solarize, then adding chicken compost for my backyard. Then my plan is to overseed something like rye. Heard root knot nematodes don't like it, and then till that in before I finally interplant my veggies with marigolds. Thanks for your awesome channel. All right, Andrew, so what I'm going to say is this, like, we want, like, in nature, there's good and bad. Always in those superhero DC movies or Marvel movies, there's always a bad guy and a good guy, right? And always in the end of those superhero movies, pretty much for the most part, the good guy always wins. And likewise, you know, there's good nematodes and there's bad nematodes. And unfortunately, in your soil, you have too many bad nematodes and not enough good nematodes to kick butt over those bad nematodes. So I'd recommend getting some beneficial nematodes in addition to the practices you are already doing. The source I would recommend for beneficial nematodes is the biologicco.com. They could supply all your nematode needs. I'd be very cautious of buying nematodes from any old place online, because you got to make sure that they are fresh, because you could be getting something that's like not alive by the time you order it. So I would definitely trust that company to get you some healthy nematodes. Now, the other thing, I would also, you know, have a backup plan. So I'd also get some good clean soil, not the existing soil, and just grow in some containers, grow in some pots, you know, along the side of your raised beds, that you have guaranteed nematode-free soil, and maybe in a different side of your yard if you have space to do that, whether it's a fabric pot or a plastic pot. I mean, my friend grows like celery in Hawaii in a bathtub, so he doesn't have nematode issues, because most people can't grow celery in Hawaii. And he gets away with it growing it in a bathtub, you know, so he doesn't have the nematode infestation that he does in his soil if you can't control it. So have a backup plan and get healthy nematodes, and also work on building your soil and your microbiology and your biology in your soil. Things like compost teas and beneficial microbe sprays, I think, could definitely help you out too. All right, next question is from a Garden Beyond Paradise. Hi, John. Is it okay to grow tomatoes the natural way without cutting the suckers? Will photosynthesis give way to more flower production? Thanks. All right, yeah, there's always that debate, you know, cutting suckers or not cutting suckers. And, you know, I mean, I've seen people do testing where they cut the suckers or not cut the suckers, and I would say it's a few things. Number one, it depends on the tomato variety. Some tomato plants sucker out way more than others. You know, it also depends on where you live. You know, I basically, unless the suckers are infected or, you know, like I get spider mites here, you know, have spider mite damage, I let all my suckers grow, because I just want more foliage on my plants. If you guys live in a place where it just gets too massive and overgrown, then pull off the suckers. You know, here's the thing. Do tomato plants want the suckers pulled off? No, that's like in our brains. You know, my friend, like when we prune trees to how we want it, not to how the tree wants it, because the tree's growing the way it wants to grow. So I encourage you guys to maybe do more of a hands-off approach with less suckers. I mean, the plant is still going to make more fruit, is going to produce more fruit one way or the other way. You know, here's the thing. It depends how healthy your soil is, in my opinion, right? If your soil is not as healthy, it may not be able to support all the extra growth on the plant, and maybe removing the suckers would be a good thing. But if you have really healthy soil that could support all the growth, I mean, the plant's not going to sucker out unless it's healthy to do so. And the goal of the plant is to produce tomatoes for you so it can reproduce and make the seeds. So the plant wants to, you know, the plant is working to make as many tomatoes as possible. And we get in the way by trimming it back and doing all these crazy things to it that we think we need to do to make it grow faster, you know, topping it off when it's still a baby so that it's pushing more growth. You know, there's so many different techniques to do. And I would say, you know, hey, do an experiment in your garden to see what's going to work for you based on your conditions, your soil conditions, your climate conditions. Plant two tomatoes next to each other, same sun conditions. Let one go crazy and pull off the suckers. See which one makes more yield. And in that one experiment, and of one, you'll learn which way is better. But you'll also learn that it's a lot of work to pull off suckers, and is it worth whatever 10%, 20% more tomatoes? And only you could determine how valuable your time is. You know, these days, I don't pull suckers off tomatoes because I ain't a sucker. next question is, Katie Krill, other than having high quality soil, how else do you deal with pests like caterpillars and aphids? All right, yes, high quality soil, tip number one. Tip number two that I recommend for you guys is beneficial insects. I've been slacking this year because normally by now I have already gotten my praying mantis, basically egg sacs, in my garden and spread out. This year I only have like maybe five because I found them in my rosemary bush that were basically left by praying mantises in my garden from last season. But normally I'll buy like at least two dozen and put them all around my garden so I have a good praying mantis supply, or basically beneficial insects. So I would encourage you guys to do beneficial insect release because, you know, then you have a hands-off approach, right? Good soil is a hands-off approach. Releasing beneficial insects in your garden is a hands-off approach because now you don't have to do the work. The beneficial insects, or the praying mantises, they love to eat those little small baby caterpillars. If they get too big, they won't eat them. But I would feed small baby caterpillars to the praying mantis. I'll just like put it on a little, I would skewer them and then give it to the praying mantis. You'd grab it and start eating it. Man, that was like the coolest ever. So I would say, And then after that, I would say, you know, hand pick them. You know, I have lots of aphids this time of year on some of my plants, not every plant. You know, if the plants are stressed out, that's gonna cause, you know, more pest outbreaks, especially in my case, aphids. I've been underwatering due to a filtration issue. And so then those plants will have more aphids than other plants that are getting proper watering. So try to ensure your plants are not stressed out, right? They're gonna get less pest infestations if they're not as stressed out. The other thing I like to do is spray high pressure water on it, or high pressure air to blow off any bugs. Of course, for caterpillars, go out at night with a black light and the caterpillars are gonna light up like little fluorescent little treats on Halloween. And you could pick them off. So yeah, and then that's what I'd say. And then after that, then you could go to like to the next step is I would use something like Dr. Zymes, which is an enzyme or some kind of enzyme for like the soft-bodied insects like aphids. And for the caterpillars, I would use an organic BT in isolated areas. I wouldn't just, you know, mass spray that or anything like that. And so yeah, but the goal is beneficial insects, the main message. All right, next question is from Chris G. Hi John, if we put in an in-ground worm compost system into a raised bed, is it possible that some of the problem pests that might result, gnats, mites, etc., might adversely affect our plants or crops in the same bed? Thank you. Absolutely. So here's the thing. You want to make sure you feed your worm food that will not cause infestation of those pests. So what do you do? I mean, it wouldn't be my first choice to put raw food scraps in the feeder. I would put those food scraps in a compost bin first, compost that down, and then feed it to your worms. That's what the better worm farms that I visit do, right? And there's reasons for their madness, right? Also feed your worms insect frass as well. So basically pre-compost stuff, so then it's already in a dry format. You know, and it's not just rotten food that could cause outbreaks. That's my solution. All right, next question is from Mike Perry. Hey John, you're the man. Question is, what's the one crop you would grow to make a small profit to help pay for some of the cost of growing green and organic? Props to Josh at Boogie Brew. So what's the one crop I would grow to, you know, make money and all this stuff? I guess it depends on your local area. You know, I would go to the farmer's market if I'm selling locally at farmer's markets and see. I would go there and observe other farmers and see what's selling good for them. Hey, this one farmer sells, you know, go to the morning, right? When they open, you could see all the tables and how they're set up and all the crops that they have. And you could see, oh, this farmer has radishes, this guy has greens, and then go when they close and then see what's sold out and what they still have. Like, oh, that guy that had radishes, he still pretty much has all the radishes. Don't grow radishes, but if the guy that has radishes sold all his radishes, I mean, that's a good indicator. Like, you know, there's a bigger radish demand than there is radish producers in your area. The other thing I'd do is I'd maybe start asking people, like, hey, what do you see here at the farmer's market that you don't have? And then grow those things. You know, that's probably my basic thing I do, because I wouldn't say, like, just grow this because you're going to be successful. I mean, high-quality cash crops, I would say, to grow would be microgreens, because you could do that in a relatively small space. Even indoors, I would grow sprouts, even, because that's, you know, those are fairly really fast-turn crops that sell for a lot of money. Another thing you might look into, and I'm no expert on by any means, is mushrooms. You could do those indoors, and I don't know if you guys price mushrooms, but, like, the local farm here that sells, like, the lion's mane mushroom and other mushrooms sells, like, mushrooms for, like, $24 a pound, which I think is a bit outrageous. But they get it! So yeah, that's what I'm tell you. Yeah, grow what is needed in your area. Also, sprouts, microgreens, and mushrooms. All right, transplanted farm. Do you use both powderized and granular azomite in your planting mix? So I used to use the powdered azomite, but pretty much I've steered clear of the powdered azomite. I like that it's more like a smaller format, ground up finer. But I really don't like having to breathe it into my lungs. I think it's, like, not good for us to breathe in any particulate. And I'm not a big fan of wearing masks. I mean, I'll wear masks when I have to, you know, but I don't like wearing masks in my garden. So now I pretty much only use the granular azomite that once it gets wet should blow up and should basically be the micronized stuff that just has some kind of binder attached to it. Next question is from G. Jones. Hello, John. I want to build a raised garden box set on cinder blocks like those in Dr. Furman's retreat, so they will be completely off the ground. How would you use 2x6s as the bottom? How much spacing do you leave for drainage? Thank you. Yeah, so I haven't been to Dr. Furman's retreat since the initial beds he put in that were in the ground, so I haven't seen his raised beds on cinder blocks. You know, personally, I would not put a raised bed off the ground. Unless there's a really important reason to. If you needed it higher because you didn't want to bend over, then I would basically just, have it soil all the way into the ground and not actually have it raised up. I think it's very important to have your plants grounded and be in contact with the real earth and not just be on legs, be it cinder blocks or wooden legs. In addition, it's just going to be a lot better because, I mean, for the 2x6s on the bottom, if you are going to do that, I would not put any spacing for drainage. Water will find a way to seep out and drain out. The other thing you may want to look into is to a self-irrigating planter bed that is basically solid on the bottom to catch the water. You know, Dr. Furman is in, like, you know, San Diego, where it's actually a quite dry climate like here, where I think, like, a sip bed, self-irrigated planter bed might be even a good thing to do. My friends in Mesquite, Nevada do it very well, and there's a guy I visited in Southern California, in Los Angeles, also doing sip beds with really great success. They use less water, especially where water can be scarce. Next question is from Zay Riefel. Hi, John. I live in the high desert in the Boise, Idaho Valley 6B. I'm wanting to grow moringa, but I've killed a few trying to keep them alive through winter. I would like them to be in ground. I see a video of your moringa tree plants in the ground. I think, how do you care for your moringa during winter, and how should I start the plant, i.e. from seed, from rooting, cutting in a pot? Thank you for all the info you produce. I've learned a lot from your gardening channel and appreciate your content. All right, so wow, 6B moringa in the ground, keeping alive in the winter. That's going to be challenging, I think. I'm in a zone 9A, and I barely could keep the moringa alive in the winter. Basically, all the top growth dies back as you cut it back, and then I just leave it. Sometimes I'll cover that area of my garden with, like, a burlap to kind of keep it warmer and even put lights in that area so things don't get too cold. Moringa does not like the 6B climate in the wintertime. You probably got snow on the ground, and it's really going to be a tough challenge to grow that in the ground. So what I'm going to tell you is this. If you want to grow moringa in the ground, you should build at least minimally a greenhouse to keep it warmer and stop the ground from freezing. If your ground freezes where the moringa tree is planted, in my opinion, is gonna die. Now, I have no experience growing moringa in the high desert of Boise, Idaho, 6B. You know, my experience is growing in a zone 9 and being in zone 10s where I see moringa flourishing year round. So I'd say build a greenhouse around it and have that so at least the soil doesn't freeze. Mulch it really heavy, cut it back, and, you know, leave the root in the ground year round and see if it comes back in the summertime. I mean, maybe even in your greenhouse have some kind of like compost or go in so it kind of keeps it warmer in there, or heater. I mean, that's probably sounds the most prudent to me, unless you have like, you know, some guy did in Colorado where he has like a lean-to into the earth and you get sun from the overhang and all this stuff. You could do all kind of crazy stuff, and that would probably work too for you, but you got to keep the soil warmer. I mean, probably a lot easier to just grow the moringa outside in a big container and then bring it into your garage that doesn't get too cold in the winter, and you could overwinter it in your house or in your garage if it is a heated garage, because otherwise your garage might get too cold too. I really don't know much about zone, anything below a zone like 9. I'm not the expert. All right. Next question is from Jones. Hi, John. I'm near Houston, and my question is about sapote trees. Would I be able to successfully grow one in the ground here? What kind would be best? I ordered a black sapote to plant in my yard. I really don't care to grow plants in pots. All right, Jones. So there's lots of sapotes. There's like mame sapote, chico sapote, white sapote, black sapote. So here's the thing. Black sapote will grow like in Florida. So in Houston, it's colder than Florida. If you lived like on the coast near like, what is that? San Padre Island, maybe you'd be able to get away with some of those things. There's a really cool nursery that I visited down there that has lots of tropical trees. But you're in Houston, and Houston with the crazy weather, I mean, maybe one year it won't freeze and one year it snows there, you're going to have some challenges growing it in the ground there. So with a lot of the sapotes, because they're more tropical and they would like more of a Florida zone 10 climate, I've gotten away with growing white sapote, which is actually the most cold tolerant sapote in Northern California, in the greenhouse in the winter. And some winters, once it got kind of big, I left it out of the greenhouse. It did all right. So I would say that is your best bet for sapote grow, white sapote, and you may have better luck with that. The other ones, I'd say if you're growing them in the ground, more chancy that you're going to lose them unless you build some kind of protection over them to keep them warm in the winter. But I'm at the point now where that's just too much work. All right, next question is from Schaefer Cox. What size containers do you use for various plant starts? What herbs do you grow and why? So let's see. I buy my plant starts. I rarely will start plants in containers. I will more likely start things from seed. I just broadcast seeds out. They come up. And then I'll move them to where I need them. I don't really start things in, you know, six packs or anything. But if I was going to start things in six packs, I would use the jumbo six pack size, which is, you know, I don't know, like probably like 2-inch, I don't know, at least two, almost 1.5-inch squares are nice and large. And then kind of any herbs or cuttings, which I do a lot of cuttings, I start those in like 4-inch round pots. And they look like kind of Dixie cups, actually. I like those a lot. And I like them because they're deep. You know, I don't like the ones that are like 4-inch like pots that are kind of like, you know, shallow. I don't like those so much. What herbs do you grow and why? I mean, I grow lots of herbs, like most edible herbs and some culinary herbs. Like I grow like cilantro right here. I got like oregano, hot and spicy oregano just grows like a weed. I got things like lavender growing. I got my rosemary bush, my sage. I got mint. I got, you can see my ashitaba growing. I got like the pennywort or gotucola. Got the jiglawan or herb of mortality. I mean, I have lots of things. I mean, oh, and I got the fo ti, Chinese herb. I mean, I try to grow a lot of herbs. Like number one, things that are gonna grow well that I'm gonna use like in my culinary preparations. And number two, like herbs that are quite extremely rare that you can't hardly find fresh and that are gonna grow good in my climate zone. So, I mean, I know I got a bunch more herbs because I've bought them different ones over the years, and whether you classify something as an herb or a vegetable is debatable. A lot of the herbs I grow, I just classify as vegetables and just eat them. yeah, so that's the answer. Next question is from J.S. Curzons. Hi, John. You have by far the best composting videos. That said, I purchased and put together a Juraform composter, and I'm excited to start using it, which, by the way, was purchased after doing some research on compost bins and coming across your video comparing it to others' compost bins you have. That said, a big question on your valuable information. Now, typically water is added when composting using other compost bins, but can water be added in the Juraform composter? Also, can chicken poop be mixed in with chicken bedding also be used in the drawer form. All right, so here's the thing. I'm gonna be the first to say that, you know, I've been dealing with my drawer forms over the last week, actually, with rust issues, and I got some of the panels replaced. So it would not be my choice to add water to the drawer form. You know, in my climate specifically, if I composted outside the drawer form in open air, the water would evaporate off. So I don't know exactly where you live. You live in a more arid climate or a humid climate, right? But what I will tell you is that I put enough food scraps in that have a high water content in my drawer form to have enough moisture in there so that I don't have to add additional moisture. That being said, you know, what I'd rather do instead of spraying water into the drawer form is if you are composting that's something really dry that you don't have the right moisture content in your drawer form, I would rather have you guys mix water in with, like, say, your chicken manure with your chicken bedding to get that wet, and then put that in your drawer form to add the moisture you need, or just add some fresh food scraps that have the moisture you need. I run my drawer forms with mostly food scraps with smaller amounts of carbon sources because I'm mostly just trying to get rid of food scraps. And so it's always too wet in mine. I could probably always add some. Once again, the secret ingredient to using the drawer form and making it work properly is the, wood pellets, you know, horse bedding pellets, kitty bedding pellets, which are like way more expensive, or, you know, even just use some wood stove pellets that are 100% wood. I prefer the softwoods over the hardwood. But yes, you can add water if you need it. I wouldn't do that. I would, once again, add it to the material. And number two is, yes, you could absolutely put chicken poop mixed with chicken bedding in the drawer form. Anything that you could compost could go in the drawer form without issue. All right, so hope that helps you out there. Next question is from Cat Funk. Hello from Oregon, John. Have clay soil I've been amending for years, but it still needs more organic matter. I've gotten chickens to help make compost faster. I'm on a limited income, so I can't buy truckloads of compost and nutrients like I would like. I don't like vermiculture or perlite in my garden. Keeping cost in mind, what would you add to help with drainage that is natural? All right, Kat. So what I would do is what my friends in Malala, Oregon have done, right? They probably have similar soil to you, and they brought in tons of free wood chips. They had the chip drop. I mean, they didn't have chip drop. They just had, like, the arborist drop truckloads and truckloads and truckloads, like lots of truckloads, on their property of the wood chips. Link down below. This adds lots of organic matter, right? We want to basically crowd out all the clay with good organic matter that's now going to bring your soil back to life, so you're going to have better drainage, right? We need to reintroduce, adding good soil on top that'll finally mix in and turn your clay soil, not clay, sounds like magic, doesn't it? This is going to take many years. I'm not going to say add sand to your clay and then it's going to have better drainage, because it's still going to clump up. But by adding biology and the wood chips, I think over time is your way. Plus wood chips you could get hopefully dropped for you for free, because now the arborists don't have to go to the landfill and pay a drop charge to drop them off. Check out Chip Drop. All right, next question is from the Urban Gardener. What keeps you going? You've been growing for years and sharing your love for growing your own food. What keeps the passion alive? I mean, this is just my life. This is what I enjoy doing. I love being out in my garden. I love preparing food. I love making videos and sharing what I've learned with others to make a small difference to you guys that are watching me on the planet and other people that want to find me and watch me. You know, in this way, I feel my life is, like, more fulfilled and rich, and that I was put on this planet for a certain reason. And maybe it's to share all this information with you. I mean, I was put on this planet and almost lost my life when I was younger so that I could find this information and share with you guys. I mean, that's my true belief on why I'm here. And I'm glad that I get to do that. And it really makes me happy when I see that, like, you know, somebody comes up to me and, like, you know, hey, John, man, you've changed my life, man. I lost weight, got healthier, I'm growing food now. You know, all these things. It's like, wow, you know, little old me with my camera, my videos online are making a difference. You know, I don't have, like, some big crew doing all this stuff. I'm just, like, doing it all myself. But it's important, man, taking time out of my day to make this video for you guys so that I can be the change I want to see in the world, right? And make a difference in the world for you guys so you guys can have a better life than I've had, you know, going through the school of hard knocks. So, I mean, that's what keeps me going, basically, being healthy and spreading the message of health, the power of fruits and vegetables, and the power of gardening, and how to basically have a better planet for everybody. All right. Next question is from Maura L. Hi, John. Love your channel, your candor, your passion. I learned something new or get an idea to try from every video. My question is, I understand rainwater is preferable to city water to avoid chlorine and chloramine, but I wonder about the pollutants in the air. I think rain picks up these, i.e. acid rain. I imagine in highly polluted areas, cities, the pollutants are not great for the soil microbiome. What's your thoughts and opinions on this? Thank you. All right, Mara. So, I mean, I agree. I mean, water everywhere is contaminated, you know? So I guess you got to pick and choose your battles. What's more contaminated? Water coming out of your spigot that they add chlorine, that's fairly easy to remove. Chloramine, hard to remove. Maybe even there might be MTBE and other chemicals in there. I mean, check your, you know, quality water quality report from your local water agency or district that could supply that to you. And even things like fluoride that could, you know, bioaccumulate in plants if you're watering your plants with that all the time. Or rainwater that could have acid rain, could have jet fuel, could have who knows what in there. And I would say, you know, hey, bubble your rainwater, and if you're super concerned, you could oxidize it, so put like a ozone bubbler in there. But at the same time, your ozone bubbler will oxidize like potential contaminants in there, but also kill potentially beneficial microbes and bad microbes in the water as well. And then I would say, if you're super paranoid, you could filter it. So, you know, here's the thing, there's always a solution for the problem that humans and man have made. So, and I guess in the end, we could get super paranoid about all kinds of crazy things. And just, you know, here's the thing, do the best you can, man. Hey, minimally, at least get a filter for your hose bib, catch your rainwater, put it out. You know, if I, the rainwater that I do catch, I don't worry about filtering, you know, because I mean, it all gets basically diluted in the soil. And here's the thing, guys, if you have good soil and good microbial action in your soil, including archaea, you know, and I introduce archaea into my soil, that I basically break down petroleum-based products purposely, right? I wouldn't be so worried about it. Plus, the plants there are there, and they're also really good filters, too. So, I mean, that's what I think. I mean, if, now, if you lived in Chernobyl, I definitely wouldn't, you'd be using the rain from over there or somewhere that had some crazy, you know, radiation contamination thing. That could be really bad. All right, next question is from Island Girl 637. Aloha mai, John. I have a sort of unique question. I am now in Central America starting a farm, but there are crops we grew back home in Hawaii that we haven't been able to find locally. I understand the concerns for pests and invasives, etc., but what about certain varieties? Calo is a sacred crop for us, and we miss having certain varieties of calo we do not find here. Is there a responsible way to get certain crop varieties from other locations? I miss the different varieties of bananas we had and organic and white pineapples. I would love to find a way to have these varieties in our garden again. Thank you for your awesome videos. All right, so you're in Central America starting a farm, and I don't know what country you're in, and I'm not a lawyer. I don't deal with import-export laws or plant laws or anything like that. And so I can't, you know, contact a lawyer or contact the agriculture department in your wherever you live in Central America and see what's legal. You know, if you need to follow the laws, you know, I mean, I know in Hawaii, you know, they won't allow, you know, agricultural products out unless they're totally certified and grown off the ground and all these things. You know, for me personally, you know, I can't tell you guys what to do, but if it was me, like, I would go to the ends of the earth to source and get the different, you know, starter plants, you know, vegetables that I needed. You know, I've ordered them online. I've gotten some things confiscated by the customs that I didn't get. Some things come through. You know, I've talked to seed collectors that go around the world and will smuggle seeds and things back in. You know, I mean, you guys got to do what you got to do. To me, it's a vitally important concept to be able to grow the foods that I want, the varieties that I want, and I will have to do whatever I have to do, trying to meet and fit into the laws whenever possible. But I'm going to do what I have to do. I mean, if it was me, I would, you know, I can't recommend you guys to do this, but, you know, I would potentially break the law. I mean, I break the law speeding in my car, like almost every day I go out driving on the freeway, you know. And I know some of you guys might be really pissed, like, John, you're a terrible person because you're going to bring back some taro root from Hawaii or something. But, you know, once again, they do an agriculture inspections. You know, I mean, I just got back from Puerto Rico and I brought back things that were allowed, and there's certain ways you could bring back plant starts without any soil on them, for example, and bring those back legally. out of Hawaii, and then could you bring those to Central America? I mean, I haven't been to Central America in a long time, but I don't think they do agriculture checks at that when you fly in. But you know, that's all up on you. I claim no responsibility. So yeah. Oh, and then also too, there's a clean way to do that. So in the U.S., anyways, they're now doing tissue cloning that's totally sterile, so it's not going to introduce any kind of foreign diseases or pests in an area that's not supposed to. So there's some companies in Florida that are doing tissue cloning of rare banana and pineapple varieties, actually, to keep the genetics alive, but also provide clean starts for people that want to grow them, actually. So you could look into that. I don't know the companies that are doing that off the top of my head, but a quick internet search should help you out with that. But then the question is, they may not ship to Central America, so you might have to come to the United States on vacation, pick up a lot of those clones, and then go back with you. And then make sure it's legal to do so. I mean, there's a book they wrote, like, "Everything I Want to Do is Illegal." That's the title of a book, and, you know, I mean, the world's getting crazy. Anyways, all right, continue on. Next question is from Wendy Salcido. "Hello, John. I was a little frustrated in ordering seed catalogs this year. I do not have a computer or Wi-Fi. Some of the organic heirloom seed plant catalogs are digital. Can you share some of your favorite catalogs that still mail physical paper catalogs for those of us without other resources? Thank you. Hope all is well with you. Thank you for your channel and social media accounts." All right, Wendy. So let's see. So you don't have a computer or Wi-Fi, but you must have a phone to follow my social media accounts and watch this video on. So, you know, I would say, you know, everything's going digital and a lot of companies aren't printing catalogs anymore to save trees and to save costs, frankly. I mean, the number one still best catalog for seeds ever that's still printed, that you could even spend money to get the enhanced catalog that's almost the size of a small phone book from some cities. Do they even make phone books anymore? Is rareseeds.com or Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds. They have the world's best catalog, in my opinion. And they have an extremely large variety of different plants and seeds, actually, that you're not going to find anywhere else, like literally. So, I mean, I'd recommend them as like my primary go-to. You know, I am on the mailing list for many different seed companies and get catalogs, but, you know, I think due to COVID, they stopped sending them to me. I used to like the Johnny's Select catalog because Johnny's also has some really cool stuff and they still have a solid printed catalog. I think Johnny's is still printing their catalogs out. And there's, you know, there's some other smaller seed companies. And I don't know if they're still doing catalogs or not, but you know, some of these small seed companies, I really like some like local and regional seed companies. So I look into like local and regional seed companies. I don't know where you live exactly, but try to find some seed companies near you and visit them, right? To find the seeds that have been grown and cultivated and from your area, so you could grow those because they're going to do a lot better. You mean, look up seed sharing in your area and find other farmers and gardeners that are growing and sharing their seeds. I mean, that's the number one resource, I think, for people, you know, instead of even buying seeds. And, of course, save your own seeds. I mean, I've bought seeds from, like, eBay and, you know, Amazon and all this. I prefer eBay over Amazon or even Etsy. Etsy would be a great resource if you could, like, look at stuff online. You know, there's a lot of rare seeds. And, I mean, I'm really into the rare stuff. I don't really need to buy common seeds because, actually, I don't start a lot of seeds. I buy plant starts mostly. All right. Wow. We're down to the last question today. It's from 519 Oliveria. "Hello, John. Thank you for all the work you have put in over the years, adding so much valuable information to the community. My question is, could you list off some organic inputs like moringa powder, spirulina, dandelion powder, and other that you are more aware about that are beneficial to gardens and how they should be used? Further details of other inputs such as L-aminos and other advanced ingredients would be greatly appreciated. Once again, thank you for everything. Cheers from Ontario, Canada." All right. Wow, that's an advanced question. So here's the thing, right? Like organic inputs like moringa powder, spirulina powder, and dandelion powder, like into your garden, like just the powders alone. Like that's kind of crazy because, I mean, like food grade powders are really quite expensive. So this is like really advanced level. I mean, most people would never get into this. I mean, I think I've only heard of like one farm that I visited like putting spirulina powder into their farm. That's because there's a spirulina factory that makes the spirulina and they get basically all the reject spirulina that can't be sold as food grade. And then they actually add that to their garden. So I think that's actually a really good idea. Now, instead of buying all these exotic moringa powders and you know, neem seed meal, which actually could be a good thing to use in your garden, in my opinion, which isn't super exotic. You know, I'd rather have you guys, if you want to add dandelion powder into your garden, grow dandelions or just harvest some wild dandelions, chop it all up, blend it into a blender under vacuum so you don't lose those valuable antioxidants and oxygen-sensitive nutrients. Blend them in and then pour it into your soil, into your crops, right? Maybe even just compost it first and then put it in, you know? I mean, there's definitely benefits to different plant auxins and different kind of properties in every different plant, you know, that could feed your soil. I don't know them all, but I know one farm did do spirulina. I haven't heard of people adding moringa powder to their garden. And if I have moringa powder that's too old for me to eat, my first choice is not to actually put it to my garden, but to give it to my animals, in which case Oakley. So he gets a lot of the old spirulina and chlorella that's past dated. So then he could at least benefit from it. And I don't put his poop in my garden yet, although I might do that with bokashi fermentation one of these days. But I am aware of they do sell like aloe powder to put in gardens, and that will definitely help out your garden. But instead of like buying this exotic aloe powder that could get quite expensive, grow some aloe and then blend that up. I'm going to probably have a video on that really soon, how I do that to enrich my garden with aloe, you know, the properties in the aloe plant without buying some freeze-dried, properly harvested and dried aloe. Fresh stuff is always best, guys. So, you know, grow your own moringa if you got extra moringa. Hey, even if you want to juice it, that's probably the best way. Juice it instead of just blend it with water and then pour the juice that I would dilute and then pour it into your garden. Like, what's going to happen? I mean, I could barely make enough juice for me to drink. Although I will say that if I have juice that goes bad in the fridge, it's not properly stored, I will pour it in my garden. I'll dilute it down and pour it in my garden all the time. Right? Let's see what... I bought some like apple juice and some other sweet beverages that I don't drink myself for like a video to like use as a prop. And then what did I do with those? I added it to my compost tea. And actually, that'd probably be my first resource to like add nutrients to my garden. I would want to add things like the powders to the compost tea mixture and then bubble it up and then use the tea in my garden. Like, we would make tea out of some of these things. And then I would also then take that, all the mash from the tea waste, and then spread that around some of my more valuable plants, right? So that's what I would do. You know, I don't really know about like, oh, and then aminos, like using amino acids in the garden. Like, I would just get pure protein. I mean, that's an agricultural grade amino acid. I mean, you could get the, you know, the one from soy if you're vegan. But I mean, why have to recreate the wheel or use like things that are made for food grade now in our gardens, which could have benefits. I'm not up to date on all the things people are doing, but I know some of the common ones, you know, like what they do in the cannabis industry, you know, is kind of what I'm more familiar with. I mean, of course, you could use kelp in your garden, like soluble kelp, and just ground up kelp in the garden, and I recommend adding that and using that as well. So yeah, hope I was a little bit helpful. I'm definitely by no means, you know, an expert on adding all these exotic ingredients. I had enough ingredients already. But anyways, that's pretty much the end of this episode. Hey, if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. If you got a question for me, link down below to my community tab so that you could post your question there. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else you think it can help. If you like this episode, make sure you click the thumbs up. This helps the YouTube algorithm get this out to more people. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss my new and upcoming episodes. I come here every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the bell, guys, and maybe make sure the bell is clicked so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. And past episodes are Wealth of Knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.